How stress rewires your brain and what you can do about it. That was the title of a recent video I saw by the Seeker channel, and it was a great video, but it didn't explain a whole lot about how stress rewires the brain or the mechanisms involved. So I thought I'd fill in a few things. They gave you some great tips. They basically said exercise and sleep and meditate, but I thought I'd explain a little more about how that actually works. So first of all, you have in your brain, you have brain cells, and they do what they do because they're connected to each other. You have about 100 billion brain cells, and they make connections. So each brain cell makes on average about 5 to 10,000 connections. So you imagine the complexity of that neural network that handles everything about you. Another thing we need to understand is brain cells are just like muscles, that if you work them out, then they get stronger. So you work out a muscle by putting tension on it, and then it grows, it hypertrophies. If you don't use it, it shrinks, it atrophies. Brain cells are the same way, but you don't put tension on them, you send signals to them and between them. So the more connections a brain cell has, the more likely that it's going to be part of some communication, the more likely that it's going to get stimulated and get hypertrophied and stay strong. So the stability of a brain cell depends on, of course, the nutrition it gets, but also the number of synapses, how many connections, how well anchored, how many roots does it have, if you will. So in order to make new synapses, you need two hormones. In the video, they talked about one called BDNF, means brain-derived neurotrophic factor. But you need one more hormone, and that's human growth hormone. And the best way, the single best way to create those two hormones is exercise. And a little bit of exercise gives you a little bit of those hormones. High intensity exercise gives you a lot of those hormones. So while low intensity, long duration, like walking, is good for circulation, it will give you a tiny little bit of this. What's more important is actually the intensity. So if you do short bursts, like high intensity interval training, for even just a few seconds, then you're going to increase your levels of these hormones by 300 to 400%. And the other good way to increase them is fasting. So high intensity exercise and fasting is the way to increase these hormones. And the other part of this is the complexity. So your neural networks will be as complex as the challenge that you put on them. If you vary your behavior, if you teach yourself a lot of different skills, whether it's physical skills or thought skills, then you're going to need a very complex network to handle that. When we're born, we actually have a lot more, a larger number of brain cells than we have as we get older. Brain cells die off. We wean off the ones we don't need, but the ones we need are the ones that are connected to others. So we actually increase the number of connections, the number of synapses, as we gain more experience, as we get wiser, as we gain more skills, and especially if we stay active and keep developing, then we increase the number of synapses, but we decrease the number of brain cells. And exercise and complex behavior is the number one way to maintain the complexity of these neural networks. And the more connections we have, the stronger the brain cells are, the more stable and solid they are. So when we have neurodegenerative diseases like Alzheimer's and Parkinson's, then the cells are losing their strength, they're degenerating, and a large part because they don't get stimulated through exercise, we don't have these hormones in place, and we don't maintain the complexity and the variation in our activities. Nutrition, of course, is another important part, but it's not the topic of this video. So stress, exercise is stress, but it's a good form of stress. It's a form of stress that we're designed for. Stress breaks you down and then you rest, you recover and you rebuild. So exercise is a challenge. And when we challenge the body, it makes these hormones so that we can rise to the challenge, so that we can become better, so we can build stronger cells with more connections. So it's not the exercise that does it. Exercise is the challenge that breaks down. Recovery is the thing that produces the health and the result. And short-term stress is what we're designed for. But there is another form of stress that's called chronic stress. And that's the stuff that people hear about. That's what we mean when we talk about stress, that it's bad for us. Because this is a little bit of stress. It's not enough to challenge us. It's just enough to wear us down. And it goes on and on and on and on, day after day, week after week, year after year. And when it does that, it does not produce these hormones. It does not challenge the body. But what it does is this. It reroutes the blood flow from the cortex to the brainstem. So the cortex is the surface layer of your brain. This is where your humanity, your creativity, your thinking, your motivation, all those things that make us uniquely human, is a function of the cortex, of the surface layer. But when we get stressed, then that part of the brain becomes less active. And the blood goes from the cortex down into the brainstem, to the primitive, to the survival brain. So we get more into the animalistic, to the instinct, to reflex action. And that's where we lose our creativity, our humanity, if you will. So that's how stress rewires the brain, by shifting the blood flow and inhibiting all of these functions that keep your brain vital and strong and alive. So get some exercise to challenge your body, make some hormones, then get some rest so that your body can recover, and then get some meditation so that you can reduce the chronic stress, so you can calm your mind, so you can help your mind settle down a little bit. Please share this with as many people as you can, because these are things that are affecting all of us. We have an aging population, and these are things that you want to start caring about and being concerned about before they become a problem. Once you have Alzheimer's and you have some degeneration, oftentimes it's too late to really do something about it. So prevention is much, much better. Make sure you subscribe and hit that notification bell so that we can keep this content coming your way. And thanks for watching.